So, the fourth in this series then is Jyrki Ilve from Finland, who is again, in a sense, going to talk about providing repository services at a national level, but also some universities doing their own thing, as it were, I understand.
Yeah, in Finland, that is the way we are doing things at the moment. And as you said, my theme is Shared and Not Shared, providing repository services on a national level. And my presentation is shared services in a very, very concrete form from the point of view of a national service provider from a small Northern European country, which, as you might guess already, is called Finland. And as you may or may not know, Finland has a relatively uniform higher education sector, and we have a government which is committed to building cost-efficient national infrastructures, and of course, sometimes with success and sometimes with not quite a lot of success. And my employer, the National Library of Finland, is an independent institute within the University of Helsinki, which is the biggest university in Finland. And of course, we have a beautiful main building, which you can see here, and we have lots of books and both old and new. But we are also a very important national service provider for the whole Finnish library network. And we have about 70 employees working on things like integrated library systems for the universities and universities of applied sciences. And we are building national discovery portals. And also, we are doing acquisition of e-materials for different Finnish organizations. And of course, we are also building repository services. And the repository situation in Finland is currently this. We have 48 Finnish organizations with some kind of institutional repository. But on the other hand, we only have 10 public repository instances. And how is this possible? The National Library is running 4 public DSpace instances for 36 different customer organizations. And in addition, 6 of the bigger research universities have their own locally run DSpace or Fedora instances, mostly for their own stuff. And here we can see, at least those in the very first rows can see, a listing of Finnish repositories at the moment. And the blue bar represents the number of all items, including those which contain non-public full-text content, and also those which only contain metadata. And as you can see some of the archives all have quite a bit of non-public items or metadata-only items. And the red bar represents the number of open access full text content in each of the repositories. And if you look at our market share as a repository service provider in Finland, we have about 75% of Finnish organizations with a repository using our services. But the number of the amount of repository content in our repositories is somewhat smaller, but still well over 50%. And as we already heard in the previous presentation, and we are by no means the only one providing centralized repository services worldwide. There are of course several other examples from other countries as well. But we are still in a minority, and most of the repositories in the world are doing all of most of the things independently. And I think the main reason for this is the original vision of the repository movement. We all know that the institutional repository should be built on a local level, and they are harvested to centralized search engines or portals specializing on scholarly content. And there's also the strong factor of do-it-yourself-oriented ideology behind the repository movement. And we all know that anyone with a bit of technical know-how can set up a repository instance, and consequently every organization should have one. And as a result, we have a very large global network of mostly separately hosted repository software instances, which of course means that we are doing the same things over and over again in many different organizations. And in addition, some of the repositories are poorly resourced, and some have little content, although these are not always the same organizations. And my question is that, does this always make sense? And as you might have guessed already, the answer is that probably not. And the use of a shared or hosted service would be in many cases worth consideration and might provide significant advantages, including cost savings, better resource services, and maybe even better services. And as you already know, Finland is not a special case. There are other examples, but still there seems to be a much more going on, much more sharing going on than in many other countries. And one of the reasons behind this is, as you already heard, the Finnish university libraries have a long tradition of building shared services together. And also our main funder, Ministry of Culture and Education, has strongly supported the creation of centralized national infrastructures, which in practice often means money. And currently, repositories are one of the centralized services provided by the National Library. But on the other hand, although we have this fundable tradition to build on, we don't have permanent central funding for repository services. And actually, we have struggled quite a bit during our history to build these services. And at the moment, all of the funding for these services comes directly from our customer organizations. And here's some historical background for these services. As in many other countries, in Finland, many of the current repositories started out publishing theses and serial publications about 10 to 15 years ago. And actually, the National Library was involved in this by running the e-thesis service for the University of Helsinki. And the concept of institutional repository, as we know it now, was only introduced a few years later. And around this time, the National Library came up with the idea of building a digital object management system. This was seen as an integral part of the new system architecture at the time for the Finnish library network. The other parts of the architecture was the integrated library system and metasearch portal. And the first attempt to build this was made with a proprietary software platform, which didn't work out as had been planned. And by 2006, we were forced to look for other solutions, and we made an evaluation of open source repository software and decided to choose DSpace. And the main reasons for this were the quick implementation process and also DSpace's suitability for multi-institutional use, which was one of the DSpace's strong points at the time compared to some other solutions. And we were also one of the early adopters of the Mannequin interface for DSpace because of this. But we did have some challenges early on. And our original idea was to collect all of the stuff and all of the organizations into one big DSpace instance, which was called Doria and which we opened in February 2007. But the new service was not an instant success. And we started out with about 10 custom organizations, some of which were quite large and some of which were small. But this wouldn't have been enough to sustain the service at the level that we were aiming for. And instead, many of the universities chose to upgrade the repositories that they already had. And some of these were actually getting quite sophisticated at the time. And also, some of the local repository managers criticized the creation of a national service. And my own theory is that the national repository services were perceived as a threat to their own local plans, and they were afraid that they would be forced to use the national services against their own will. And if there's some general lesson in this, I think it's that the advantages of the shared or hosted repository model often have more appeal to funders and library leaders than to repository managers. But then we got lucky. And in late 2007, the Rector's Conference for Finnish Universities of Applied Sciences got a two-year funding from the Ministry for TCUS, the Common Repository for All Finnish Universities of Applied Sciences. And luckily for us, we were chosen to be the service provider for this. And although there were some difficulties in the beginning, the new service was adopted in all 25 organizations by 2010. And the other lucky strike that we had was the Cultural Materials Depositing and Preservation Act, which gave us new duties in web archiving and long-term preservation of web content. And it also gave us funding for a new server infrastructure, which gave us a chance to rebuild the repository services in a new environment and this time do it right. And we introduced standardized virtual servers and started to use SVN version control of the DSpace code, which made it much easier to do upgrades and build separate DSpace instances. And in our current service model or models, the work, the maintenance of the repositories is divided between the customer organizations and the national library. And of course, the creation of publications and collections is done locally, and this is always most of the work that is being done. And the National Library is responsible for the development and maintenance of the technical platform, including servers and DSpace code and different technical interfaces and so on. And the customers may use either one of our multi-institutional repository instances, or they can use their own DSpace instance hosted by the National Library. And the technical maintenance of all instances is highly centralized, but there are a lot of differences in the processes and in the level of standardization between different DSpace instances. And our biggest instance at the moment is Theseus, which is a multi-institutional repository instance with very standardized processes. And as I already said, it's a common repository for all of the 25 universities of applied sciences. And it's growing very fast with about 13,000 new publications each year, mostly student theses submitted by students who are graduating from these universities. And all of these organizations use the same tools, same metadata formats, and same processes. And they have, and all of the collections and communities have the same uniform appearance. And this is essentially a big group effort with more than 200 librarians and administrators participating in all of these organizations. And due to the standardization of processes, the technical maintenance of the service requires very little dedicated work. About, I think it's less than 1 man-year annually. So it's quite a small amount of work. And as you might guess, the cost of managing 25 repositories separately in each organization would be several times higher. Our second biggest instance is Doria, which is a multi-institutional repository instance with diverse processes. And the original idea behind Doria was to create a neutral technical platform that any organization could easily adapt for their own use. And like in Theseus, all of the customer organizations have their own communities, but the organizations are given relatively free hands in managing their own communities. And they have many different submission processes, and in some cases they use the DSpace built-in submission tools, and in some cases they have their own external submission processes. And also many of the communities have their own visual teams and their own metadata formats, but on the other hand, there are some downsides to all of this freedom. The quality of metadata in Doria is not uniform, and also the customized community level user interfaces may appear confusing to end users, so there's a price to this freedom. And also Doria contains also some of our own collections, including this one, which contains some of the earliest dissertations published in Finland in the 17th, 18th, and early 19th century. But we are also providing separate repository instances for individual customer organizations, because some of the organizations just simply prefer to have their own hosted instance. And currently this is very easy for us, and we can provide separate instances for a small extra cost. And in May we opened Julkari, which is the repository for the National Institute for Health and Welfare, which is one of the biggest state research institutes in Finland. And it may be expanded to include other related organizations later on, so it may grow to be a multi-institutional repository too. And in June, less than a month ago, we opened Tambu, which is the new new repository of University of Tampere, and it replaces three of the previous locally run repositories, although some of the content is not yet there, and it will be there later. And we are also working on a third new separate instance, which will be made for a State Research Institute and will be opened later this year. And it seems that we are in the business of selling repository services, which is quite interesting. And we haven't really done much of marketing. We haven't gone after the customers. They have mostly came to us and asked for services. And it seems that there is a strong practical need in many organizations for a system that can be used for storing and dissemination of digital publications. And for us, long-term access and persistent addresses, and we are using URNs, have been good selling points. But of course, you should be able to integrate the repository with the other systems and processes of each organization. And while the current repository software platforms have their limitations, they are still quite suitable for the management of several kinds of digital content. And of course, much of the discourse on open repositories has concentrated on one very specific use case, which is the green OA. But there are other use cases that are just as legitimate if they are done properly. And of course, we are not trying to make a profit, but we still have to make ends meet in our own budget. And actually, this has caused us some problems because we are still trying to establish a coherent pricing scheme for all of the customers. And this is partly because some of the early deals we made while we still had project funding and we're hoping for more were actually quite generous. But we are still trying to keep the basic services relatively cheap, because many of the customer organizations are small and they actually do quite well with the basic repository functionalities and require relatively little customization. But we can also provide consulting and other services. We can do conversions, we can do extensive customization, and we can build technical interfaces to other systems if necessary. And this, of course, costs quite a bit more, but we are trying to come up with solutions that benefit other customers and maybe even other organizations as well. Of course, the growth of our customer base is bringing us some new challenges, and we really do need a better administrative model, because negotiating contracts with all of the customers, not including luckily TCOs, which is another issue, is really quite time consuming. And another problem is that how to balance customer projects with the development of the basic infrastructure. And of course, there's a constant need for new and improved services. We are working on a new, more customizable external ingest system. And we are also thinking about dark archiving on a national level so that it would have connections to the national long-term preservation system, which is currently under planning. And we are also building standardized interfaces to other systems and processes, including the library catalogs and current resource information systems. It's very likely that some of the Finnish universities are going to host their own repositories even in the future. And actually, I don't see this as a problem. But we really do need cooperation between different repositories and all of the repository managers and all of the people who are working with them. And this would benefit us all, both in the technical development of things and also in policy issues. And there has been a lot of interest in national cooperation, but we are still looking for ways to make it work better. And the best picture on the right is from a meeting we organized for repository managers about a month ago, and we had about 80 people there, although some participated online. And another issue is our contributions to the international community, which haven't been too great so far, and we are working on that and try to behave better from now on. And a couple of last slides are about the measures of success for repositories, and of course there are different levels of success. One measure is that there is a repository, and the repository should be filled with meaningful content, and the content is probably downloaded by someone. And here you can see some figures from TCOs. We have about 4 million downloads during the first 6 months of this year. But also there are some things that are a little bit harder to measure. The conduct may have some kind of scientific or cultural impact. And by storing and disseminating the content, the repository has an effect on the way we publish and access these materials. And of course, this is relatively similar to what we heard from Cameron Nailon earlier this day. And if you take another look at the publications in each Finnish repository, here you can see the content types in all of these repositories. And I'm not going to go through this very thoroughly, but as you can see, they all look very different. And none of them are quite alike, and the content profiles of the Finnish repositories are actually quite different. But if you put all of these things together, you get a graph like this. And as you can see, we are not doing very well on self-archiving. And although it has been very important in creating publicity and getting funding for the repositories, the number of submitted articles has grown very slowly. Of course, we are still working on that, and I hope that we have different kind of numbers next year or the year after that. But on the other hand, the open access publication of theses and dissertations has been a great success story for us, and it has changed the way the scholarly publishing works in Finland. Because the Finnish Literature Society, which is the most important publisher for humanities in Finland, announced a year ago that they will stop publishing dissertations, and they recommended that all of the dissertations should be published in repositories. So that was some great news for us. And I think that was just about all. Any questions?
Hello, I'm Sarah Gould. Is this working? Sarah Gould from the British Library, ETHOS Service Manager. ETHOS is the UK eThesis National Aggregation Service run by the British Library in partnership with UK Higher Education. Anybody who is familiar with ETHOS their head will be ringing with bells listening to everything that you've said today, because we've come across a lot of the same challenges in developing the ETHOS services we've gone along. Hopefully I'll catch up with you to talk to pick your brains on lots of areas later on during the week. But I just wondered about the relationship between the National Library and those repositories which aren't part of your national repository. Do you record the metadata in any of your national bibliographies, national catalogues, on behalf of those other repositories?
That's one of the things that we are still working on, and I don't have an answer for that. I think it's in most cases it is actually its organization which does this, because we have a common national database called Linda, which contains all of the stuff from all of the universities, and I think it comes from its organization individually.
Thank you. My name is Sandra Collins. I'm from the Digital Repository of Ireland, and I think we're trying to do something similar to you. I have two questions. Could you say a little more about the coherent pricing system and how really your thoughts on that, or any details you can give us? And the second question is, do you think it would have been possible to become self-sustaining, to get off the project funding without national, your act, your legislation, and without the support on the theses?
I think I answered the last question first. I think it would have been very hard, and of course we have had to struggle quite a bit even this way. And the main problem for funding situation is that the National Library has very many important national projects, and we are actually competing in, within the library also, so we don't always get to talk to the ministry if we could get the money, so it's also an internal struggle within the library. About the first question, could you read?
Any details you could give us on a pricing system? On
yeah, of course. We have a basic price for the basic repository services, which is quite low. It depends a bit on the size of the organization and the amount of stuff they are going to put there, and of course the number of processes that they need. But it's still in thousands of euros, not tens of thousands. But if you do extensive customization or build interfaces to other systems, of course it costs more, tens of thousands of euros probably, depending on the customer and what they want and how much work it costs, how much work we want to fill their requirements.
I was just wondering, comparing your approach to other national libraries, my impression is that you're very service-oriented and really driving this as a business unit. And I was just wondering, is this something that the National Library of Finland also does in other projects, or are you kind of the special case in this respect?
We are partly a special case that we have many other projects, some other big projects that get a lot of funding from the ministry, and of course they get the funding from the ministry and they don't have to charge the organizations all that much, but we are in a different situation because we don't have the stable funding from the permanent funding from the ministry. So we have, this is something that we just had to do. It's not been hoped for in the beginning.
Thank you very much indeed.